So, the Arab Islamic conquest during the early Middle Ages led to major political and cultural change in the Iberian Peninsula. The early Muslim medieval presence is quite well documented based on the evaluation of archaeological and textual historical sources. But I will pay attention to a peripheral area of the north of the Middle Mark, a large territory of the Oriental North Plateau area of the Iberian Peninsula. Currently, this area belongs to the Spanish administrative region of Soria, province of Castile León, and North Guadalajara, Castile-La Mancha. And it spreads as far as Madrid through the Henares River. Most of this area was characterized by poor soil and dry farming areas devoted primarily to the production of cereals. But irrigation agriculture was also practiced in the rich alluvial lands along the Henares, Jalón, and Naguima rivers. This territory integrates a specific geographical unity defined as a contact space between both plateaus, north and south, of the Iberian Peninsula and provides a natural corridor to the Mediterranean area through the Ebro. The settlement Umayyad power in the northeast of the medieval frontier is a process quite well established through written Islamic sources. Between the 8th and 9th century, different Berber lineages, clients of the Umayyad lords, were settled in this area. Years later, after the domination of Al-Rahman III as Caliph, this area was revealed and became the most active frontier with Christianity in Al-Andalus between the 10th and 11th century. Who ruled the territory in the north of the middle frontier? What kind of society was living there? Is it possible to recognize the Berber impact in this area? How can the Islamic State influence in the north of the middle frontier can be recognized, and how did Muslim domination reshape the landscape in this area? What kind of relationship was established with the indigenous population? How can we recognize the trace of indigenous population in this area? To answer this question, the article analyzed written sources, post-chronicle and Islamic legal texts, as well as archaeological data, in order to enlighten both the trace of Berbers, Umayyad power and indigenous population, and the relationship between victors and vanquished. The question of how and why archaeology has been used to construct identity has now emerged as one of the subject's biggest questions. Identity is always a dynamic process, always under constant cultural revision, and is subject to political, economical, and historical force. The scientific background, which has also become the subject of debate of all this question, concern concepts as ethnicity, ethnic groups, and their identity. One of the most salient definitions of ethnic group is the Marx Weber ones, human groups that entertain a subjective belief in their common descendant because of similarities of physical type or of custom of both. Because of memory of colonization and immigration, conversely, it doesn't matter whether or not an objective blood relationship exists. Different definition of ethnicity has been made from the idea of habitus developed by Bourdieu. It is necessary to examine models of social interaction and the distribution of material and symbolic power between groups of people in order to understand their self-definition and their self-conscious representation of their identity. But what is the role of material culture in the definition of ethnicity? Florin Curta emphasized that ethnic identity cannot be conceived without the manipulation of material culture. Ethnicity can be and truly is represented by such things as dress elements, speech form, lifestyles, footway, and the like. Selecting symbols to mark ethnic boundary is a political strategy. However, it is difficult to define the ethnic and religious ascription of the inhabitants, whether Berbers, Arabs, or Christians, without falling into the trap of cliches. What kind of archaeological items can be used for teasing ethnic and religious boundaries? In this sense, this paper focuses on the possibility of archaeological data as marker of identity and cultural change. Three important families were established in the north of the Middle Mark: the Banu Salim, the Banu Mada from the Masmuda tribe, and the Banu Thirwal from the Magila tribe, of all of them from North Africa. The members of these families were Mawali, Umayyad clients, lords of the frontier, and being responsible for defense and fiscal control of this territory. The historical territory ruled by Banu Salim family is located in the currently Spanish administrative region of Sorian province, Castile León, and North Guadalajara, Castilla La Mancha, and it spreads as far as Madrid through the Henares River. The area between Medinaceli and Guadalajara was cited as Ar Banu Salim by Al-Udri and Al-Istarji in their geographical works. According to Yakut, Tariq found the ruined Medinaceli in the early year of the Muslim conquest, but he does not mention the arrival of the installation of this important family. The first mention is provided by Ibn Hayyan when speaking of the death of Farai ibn Masarra Salim, Lord of Guadalajara, grandson of Salim, founder of the dynasty in the year 832. This territory in the north of the Middle March expanded progressively with a member of the family becoming Amil, that's mean governor, of the new city, and it had an important strategic position in controlling the constant rebellion in Toledo and Zaragoza against the Cordoban power. The Banu Zirwal were established in the north of the Soria region. They are coming from the tribu Magila, from Magrib al-Aqsa, and Ibn Zirwal, the founder of the Zirwal family, came to the Iberian Peninsula in the Abderrahman I period, and his successor, El-Hid Ibn Zarwid, continued as Mawali of the Umayyad family in the Al-Hakam II period. This family was established in the Moncayos area near Agreda. This territory was named by Ibn Hafs as Muntanilla. The Banu Mata were established in the northeast of Soria region, Gomara's field. As prescribed Ibn Hazm, this family belonged to the Masmuda tribes. Moreover, Ibn Hayyan makes explicit mention of the founder of the family, Amril ibn Timlit al-Tagri, and his successor who ruled this territory until the end of the 10th century. How can we recognize Berber population in this area? Can we use pottery in this area as marker of ethnic ascription? Are they using different settlement patterns? What kind of old building can be associated to these Berber families? Concerning pottery, we must be cautious in setting the Berber pattern in medieval pottery. In fact, we cannot extrapolate the current ethnic pattern used in pottery to the past. The analysis that has been made in the Banu Warigwal area in the north of Morocco highlights the difference between pottery made in the 9th and 10th century and the current pottery of this region. As a matter of fact, there has been a drastic evolution, both morphological and decorative, and the only common pattern is the handmade manufacture. Indeed, establishing an ethnical fixed pattern seems risky. The families established in our area were Umayyad Mawali. In this sense, they must be converted to Islam, and they were highly Arabicized. There is no trace of handmade pottery with particular decoration. Indeed, pottery associated with these new powers in towns is recognized through new Islamic forms such as current cooking pots and jars, and manganese painted and glassed pottery, and we can see through the sequence of Medinaceli. Nevertheless, reticulate manufactured well-made pottery has been found in Medinaceli and the site called Los Casares. That could suggest the survival of particular local Berber tradition. But if this hypothesis can be suggested, indeed there is not really a comprehensive set of pieces similar to the North Africans on one such as Nakur to support the existence of ethnic tradition in medieval pottery in the area. Regarding civil construction, the archaeological impact of these families cannot be detected specifically in the towns founded by the lordship in the Emiral period, but the trace of their presence are tangible through the anthroponymy analysis has been provided in the recent study of Pilar Sar conducted for the Upper March. The toponymy can be a very useful source if we use it wisely and we appreciate the information that it provides use in perspective. Thus, in many cases, the finding may be open to numerous interpretations. Therefore, it is essential to cross the data with those of other sources of information. In fact, the Berber settlement can be confirmed through various means, the writing documentation, the toponymical sources, and finally the archaeological sites. concerned frontier area, both geographical and chronicle source mentioned Madina Salim, Kalal Salam, Guadalajara, that's mean Guadalajara, associated with the Banu Salim and other sites like Torre Amril, near Noviercas, associated to the Banu Amril. Berber's lordship represented the supralocal power, the agents between the inhabitants and the Umayyad power. The immaterial traits can be detected in a square tower that can be recognized by their system of construction similar to Umayyad models. They are dressed with random aslar according to the header and stretcher bonding technique. Using this technique denotes a particular desire to be associated with the Umayyad, but their economic power was limited and is reflected in the poor quality of the masonry. Different examples can be shown as the Casares Tower in Riva de Saelices and the site called Algarve Tower in the Banu Mada area. Regarding the Jihad, fortification and Umayyad power, the Castilian Condal powers began to their expansion around 912 in the Duero area, and the Banu Salim family was dismissed in 920. But the other families continued as Umayyad clients till the end of the 10th century. In 10th century, the north of the Middle March was controlled directly by the Umayyad power, appointing governors and refortifying sites such as Medina Celi in 946, and other small towers such as Conquezuela, Bujarrabal or Barbatona. A number of new towers were created, such as Mezquetillas or the Tower of Alcubilla de las Peñas, in order to protect and control the principal roads from Medina Celi to Gormaz and Berlanga. Written documents concerning the campaign led in the region by the Umayyad and Castilian kings during the second half of the 10th century mention the principal castle in the region, that's mean Gormaz, Berlanga and Atienza. These are located in a strategic spot of visual control over the landscape, organizing the defense of the corridor connecting Medina Celi with the Duero region. Gormaz was the most important fortress near the Duero River, probably built in the Abderrahman I period, later restored by Muhammad I, and mainly during the Caliphate period. An epigraph preserved in the Burgosma Cathedral Museums talks about the rebuilding of the fortress in 965, when it became the principal symbol of Umayyad power in this area. All this fortification can be understood as the jihad symbol. In fact, Ibn Idari relates the calling for jihad against infidels in 966. In this moment, the caliph wrote to the governor of the upper and lower march in order to prepare the army to fight in the Duero area. All these towers and fortifications were built according to the header and stretcher bonding technique. Their factory is of good quality, with aslar forming regular arrays that denote the economic and productive capacity of the Umayyad caliphs. Clearly, this was a supralocal strategy attesting the presence of a power aiming the control of much larger territory. In this sense, it is possible to talk about military landscape where fortification suggests an ability to organize manpower, as well as revealing how power can be expressed through a military language. The Duero frontier must be regarded as a region where the state will go to any lengths to disseminate and reinforce its symbols of identity. Regarding the dominate indigenous population under Muslim rule, 100 rock-cut tomb sites have been identified in this region. This kind of burial can be easily found through field surveys, although only two sites have been excavated to date. The great problem presented by this site is their chronological data. Substantially, these tombs are not associated with artifactual or osteological remains, but thus making this possible to determine accurate chronologies. They appear without great woods, facing east-west, and are carved into the rock with different shapes, anthropomorphic, trapezoidal, and oval. Their presence is particularly significant in Tiermes and also in various sites along Sierra de la Pela. The site, called Necropolis del Río, in Tiermes, has been excavated and dated to the 6th century. This chronology was based on a gold ring and other prestige great gods from this period. This tomb may have been reused in subsequent centuries, as has been proved by the analysis of the nearby funerary area in the form of pyramids, and thus a long-term chronology from the 7th to 10th century can be inferred as a working hypothesis. The location and size of the rock cut tomb mentioned above are widely dissimilar. They could appear as isolated tombs in a large group reflecting the site of the community which used them. Small groups are common in plain wet field areas associated with families farming. Large group indicates the existence of a village as well as varying degrees of social hierarchies, as is seen in the Minyo of Medina Celi necropolis. However, domestic structure associated with these burials have not been found in this region, so this should be the focus of future excavation and surveys. Overlapping identities in Soria landscape, Minyo de Medina Celi as a case study. The archaeological site of Minyo de Medina Celi is a clear example of how material culture items may signal different identities relative to different powers settled in this area and the relationship between the victors and the vanquished. In the same area, we found a great group of rock-cut tombs over there. They are controlled by a ruined structure in the hilltop that denotes the trace of Umayyad watchtower. You can see it here. Overlapping a precedent square tower from the early Islamic period. Different societies in this size and different ways to mark the territory, religion, and power. In conclusion, the use of pottery and building in order to identify Berbers in this area is not quite clear. Both pottery and civil building were assimilated with Umayyad ones. The Berber groups used their own names when creating new settlements and used similar construction standards to the Cordoba ones. Pottery and fortification denotes cultural change and new social construction associated to Islamic powers. The analysis of pottery offers another way to resolve questions about the chronology of sites and social interaction between conquerors and conquered. Social and religious identity can be associated with material traits. Religious patterns are reflected in the landscape, both rock-cut tombs and Islamic burials are the evidence of two different identities and two different societies. Indigenous rural communities can be recognized by their rock-cut tombs and burial sites over ancient stones with a special meaning for their own communities. The Islamic population used the makabir, the Islamic cemeteries, to integrate unobtrusively into the landscape. Finally, Caliphal state power was settled in the mid-10th century and this territory was reshaped as a military frontier. Castles and towers were rebuilt with a specific construction pattern similar to those applied in classical Umayyad construction, and some new towers were built in order to reinforce military control in this region. Thank you very much.